I think maybe we talked about it on this channel last time when I was in London, or last time, yeah. And then one of my colleagues said, I said, where did you put it? So he was, and he said, yeah, I told you. And he's English, right? English from United Kingdom. I put it in the trunk. And I turned to him, you put it in the trunk. I thought trunk is American English. And then he looked at me, I didn't say trunk. I said, yes, you said trunk. I said, yeah, because you said trunk before. I said, I didn't, yeah, I used trunk. I know, I don't use English from England, but you said trunk. I didn't even talk about it. I just asked, where did you put it? And you said, and he said, oh, geez, yeah, you're right. You see that? And I never forget that. It was a very, and exactly what you say, the influence of American English, because people keep watching it on TV. Of course. Yeah, that's right.
I mean, you know, and this is the thing, you know, this is where, when you look at these translations, particularly, you have to appreciate that the translators have got to get over this. And even when something is written in classical Arabic, there are nuances from how people speak. I mean, I must admit, it's Arabic and Farsi have a degree of consistency over the centuries that European languages don't generally. Yeah. I mean, you know, like, the Italian dialect in Sardinia is famously closer to vulgar Latin than any Italian dialect on mainland Italy. It's got features in it, like pronunciation features and whatever. And but that's the unusual thing, and possibly because people were isolated there for a long time. Between English, United Kingdom English, and British English and American English, there's a lot of archaisms in American English that descend from 16th century things that have disappeared in British English.
That's right.
So I think the same thing is happening in Arabic. It's hidden by the writing being so consistent that when you write a word, you always spelled it the way it was classically written rather than how you said it. So you might run two syllables together or something because everybody talks that way. But when you write it down, you write them clearly separate. And just makes it easier for people to come along from another place or another time and read things. So, yeah, there's a few things that relate back even to the Omar Khayyam book. The upper limb, which is also the longer of the two, is called the shooting limb, which in Arabic is Bait Arami. And it's also called the sky limb, Bait Al Ma'an. Now, Bait means house. But the use in this is a house in the zodiac. It's a curved part of a circle. And Umar Khayyam, he used this when he was discussing the relationship of archery to the heavens. And it's clearly, it goes all the way through archery. The choice of that word, because why would you talk about the house of the limb referring specifically to the bending part of the limb or the whole curvature of the limb when a house is not particularly curved?
Yeah.
But the house of the zodiac is curved.
It's curved, yes.
Yeah, it's interesting stuff. I mean, we're just skipping over this. This book, it has a lot of practical stuff. Chapters on things the archer should know. How to determine the cast of a bow. Cast is how far the arrow is shot. Its weight, which is how hard it is to pull it back, as opposed to its mass, which the Turks actually used as a substitute for its weight because their bows were so consistent that a bow that weighed more was actually heavier to draw. But that's a different thing. And the limit of the archer's strength in drawing, which is critical for teaching people how to shoot archery. You can't shoot a bow that's stronger than you. you might be able to get it all the way back, but you can't shoot it. You just let go of the string. If not shooting, it's collapsing, basically. There's a thing, there's a chapter on testing the bow before bracing. So composite bows, when they're unbraced, it can have twists and they something could go wrong, like the glue could be failing somewhere, and you can tap the bow and you can check its orientation and everything. The section on bracing is outlandish. Bracing is putting the string on the bow in the position ready for shooting. The chapter on the curvature of the bow after bracing. There's a chapter on unstringing, which on a composite bow can be quite a dangerous procedure, I found out. I own a bow that famously broke the front teeth of a famous journalist and historian in Hong Kong when he was bracing it one day. And it was, as a result, it was sold or given to a friend of mine who later gave it to me. It's not an unlucky bow. It's a very nice bow. It's just that there's a method of bracing that has an inherent danger in it for the archer if your hand gets in the wrong position on the ear of the bow. But then the next chapter, like chapter 15, on the different draws and the manner of locking the thumb and the index finger on the string and the rules of arranging the index finger upon the thumb. So early date, we're in Morocco. They are focusing on fine details of shooting, exactly as in the Persian and Turkish manuscripts. This is, everybody is aware of how important it is, how you position your hand, what you're doing. And there's another one, chapter 16, on how to hold the grip of the bow with the left hand. Now, that doesn't mean left-handed people can't shoot, but there was a clear dividing up of the parts of the hand, how it is applied to the grip of the bow, of the parts of the other hand, how they fold up together and whatever. One of the things in this that was quite unusual, it was known in the West, particularly in Italy, in the trading cities, is the method of counting using your fingers. What happened is that archers use these counting positions to indicate where the fingers are in the position of drawing. Now, there's a problem that comes from this is that people think that the counting position is the archery position. The archery position is a description. The counting, the number and the position of the fingers for the number is a description of roughly where the fingers are when you're shooting. But if you read this manual and you read Taibucha in Saracen Archery and you read the Persian translations that we've done, they may say this is the lock of 63 or 69, but they specify exactly. And it's not, if you're counting 63, it's that. But if you're doing the lock of 63, the fingers are turned further down and the thumb is there and the index finger is there. So they have the same name, they refer to the same thing, but they're different physical things. So it's very important not to get too carried away literally on these number finger flexures for the numbers and thinking that they hold the whole truth about how you should hold your hand. They are a guide. That's basically, a thing to remember. The 17th chapter on the clench, which is that, this is Faris al-Omar's translation of the Arabic word aqd, which is the lock in Turkish mandal. Then chapter 18, important drawing and its limits. How far back do you pull? This is a little bit confusing when you read it, but it's important. The section next is on aiming, then on the release, how you let go of the string, on the passage of the arrow over the left hand. So the arrow is running along over the top of your thumb. It can, if the nock is too low, it can rub hard or even cut the skin, which happens. If it's too high, it doesn't make any difference to the feeling of the left hand. It doesn't hurt you, but it has effects on how the arrow flies. But then on chapter 22, this is where it gets, like the Persian and the Mamluk manuscripts, into serious stuff. On blisters and wounds on the index finger of the right hand caused by stringing, clenching, drawing, and loosing together with the remedies thereof, it gets into the nitty-gritty. I've got a, my skin's being rubbed off there, what's causing it? And this will tell you. On the blow of the string on the archer's right thumb, which causes it to turn black and blue on the inside and beneath the nail, and sometimes results in breaking the nail. This is a thing that happens when you pull your thumb out from underneath your index finger instead of lifting your index finger off your thumb when you're shooting. This is really detailed, and it goes on for chapters.
Pete, does this book tell us, I remember because there was a question regarding Arab archery almost on the channel now, I just remember that. Does this tell us when you draw and you want to go and then shoot, does it tell you about the position of your elbows, if they were, should be bent, which one should be straight, bent, in which position, when?
It does. The all of these manuals point to the elbows and the shoulders being in line.
That's right.
And the two hands being in line with each other. There's a technique in modern hunting archery in America of bending the bow arm to get a certain degree of control and also clearance, because when you're shooting with your fingers, you have a tendency to have clearance issues of the string hitting the left forearm. But the problem with it is it doesn't work very, I mean, unless you're really strong, it doesn't work very well on heavy bows above 60 pounds. What happens is you tend to collapse both the elbow and then the shoulder starts to come right up. And you're in a very difficult, it's a very uncomfortable in the long term shooting like that. Almost invariably, they say the left arm or the bow arm should be straight.
From the beginning.
Not from the beginning, because it depends on the draw. There's a draw where you start here and push out and pull back.
Exactly.
There's a draw where you start there and pull back.
That's right.
There's a draw, even like in modern Korean, where you have one hand up, the other hand, the other arm straight, and you pull down and in. And there's the modern Mongolian draw for sur target shooting, where you you kind of start here and push out and down. All of these things were understood. Most of these manuals tend to come back to recommending methods that work well with very strong bows. Because underlying all of this was the military use of archery. The funny thing is the Turks, who their last major work on archery in the Ottoman period, Mustafa Kani's book, they weren't talking about archery for warfare, but they were still using really strong bows. And the techniques were essentially the same, because it is not, there's only so much your body can do. There's the worst things, like even the shoulder position is quite important. The best writings about it are in Chinese manuals of archery, because they wrote about it more. In the Middle Eastern ones, they told you what to do but didn't explain in detail. Of course, you had an ustad, a master, who was going to show you what to do. You didn't learn archery by yourself. You went to a teacher, And so therefore, there was a thing that we've discussed before. There were things that they assumed everybody knew because everybody who did archery had a teacher. You didn't, it would be very unlikely that a person would be wealthy enough to own a book on archery, but not wealthy enough to employ a teacher to show him how to do it. And this is, again, we live in a world where people get manuals on how to fix phones and sit down and work out how to do it. But back then, for something like archery, you were taught. And it might be you were taught by your father or your uncle or your grandfather, or it might be by a professional teacher. If you were a Mamluk, your father, grandfather, and uncle were probably back on the step, so you were taught by a professional teacher. I would imagine that in Morocco, it was probably still family-based. There were the equivalent of a khulam, but they're not, a lot of the military was tribal, so it would have been family-based teaching. It certainly in the original Arab armies, it was family-based teaching, but it rapidly became professionalized, and then you get professional teachers. So these are one of the problems. When somebody writes a book like this, they know things that they don't put down because they assume that you already know it. Otherwise, you wouldn't be reading their book. And it's a skill. Chapter 29, on the management of the arrow when shooting against the wind, etc., and on trying not to shoot when a break is found after it has been fully drawn. Now, first one, shooting with the wind is a real issue if you're shooting any distance greater than about 30 meters. If you've got a crosswind, then there's going to be some dramatic effects on it. And as my colleagues at my archery club and I have found out, because we've had some really strong crosswinds in the last month or so, blowing directly sideways across the field, the wind is not constant all the way down. So you can't just say, oh, I'll lean a bit to the right because the wind is blowing from right to left. It's there's a bit of luck involved. It's one of the reasons I think archers don't really like the wind, no matter which direction it's blowing. Some of these chapters are not logically arranged. Why these two things are in the same chapter is a bit of a mystery. But on trying not to shoot when a break is found after the arrow has been fully drawn, well, you can imagine, here you are, you're about to shoot and you're looking along the arrow and you see a splinter sticking up. Well, there's limits to what you can do. One of the things in here is you push the arrow off the bow with your chin, so it's out there, and then you let the bow down so the arrow doesn't run along your thumb and drive the splinter into you. So these are very practical things. There's a very interesting section, which I think might be from Atabari, how near or far should the target be, which I think we should look at because this is really quite interesting. Distance and what people thought was acceptable distance. This is for target shooting. It's important. It's not warfare. This is for target shooting. But so the they say archers throughout the world are agreed the shortest practical range is 25 cubits and the longest is 125 cubits, while the limit beyond which no is possible is 300 cubits. Now, a cubit is technically a simple cubit, is the distance between your elbow and the tip of your middle finger when you're holding your arm straight. There's a Turkish measure called arshin, which is basically that, but over, and zira in Arabic is the cubit. So that's how it all started out, but they varied in length. So there's a Hashimi cubit. There are Hashimi, I think. Abbasid cubit, royal cubit, black cubit, Abbasid. Their robes were black, so the black cubit. These vary. I would say my cubit, my personal cubit, is roughly 7.5, 8.5 inches, or 45 to 47 centimeters long, something like that. But some of the cubits, the canonically defined cubits, are longer. So 25 cubits could theoretically, if it's an 18 inch cubit, be 12.5 yards.
Wow.
So that would be your absolute nearest target, beginner's practice, you know, just standing in front of the target and shooting at it. 125 cubits is quite longer. There's an appendix where Farris and Elmer discuss about what the cubit was, and it's useful. There's better material now because there's been more research done into cubits and measurement systems in different parts of the Islamic world, so that makes it reasonable. They say the common cubit is 18.24 inches, which is derived from 6/5 of 3.04 inches. The black cubit, this is was used in Europe, in Egypt, and it was 7/5, which is 21.28 inches. Apparently the old Nilometer, the building that measured the height of the floods of the Nile, which was built in 861 on the island of Arda in the Gad, has its cubits on its scale, and they're 21.29 inches, so 21.28 inches, 29, that's a tiny amount, a hundredth of an inch difference. There's a long discussion of this, but he basically comes down to 25 cubits as being 14.8 yards, 125, 74 yards, which is a good range for, I mean, modern Mongolian traditional target shooting is done at 75 meters, which is just a little bit further. 140 cubits, 82.75 yards, and 300 cubits, 177.6 yards. Now, all of these are reasonable ranges. I mean, modern archers might be a bit shocked by the 176. But Korean archers shoot at 150 meters regularly with traditional equipment. No sights, no arrow rests. Just, you know, one or two new bows and bamboo arrows. It's quite reasonable. He goes into bow lengths. One archer stated that the range should be 45 bow lengths, and anyone who shoots beyond that limit commits a mistake. That is, they're shooting beyond the accurate range. Precise accurate range, I think, but failed to mention whether the bow should be braced or unbraced when measuring out the course. That's a fair thing for the Abd Allāh Ibn Maymūn to write, but in fact, measuring things by bow length, composite bows, was always done with the braced bow, because the unbraced shape of the bow could vary so much. Nothing is consistent, whereas the brace bow was a standard length. And weirdly enough, it's related to the unbraced bow, but it's constant, whereas the unbraced bow could be far bent, it could be bent like that, which would make it longer between the tips, which is what you're using to measure with. So yeah, braced bow is the way to go. Weirdly enough, over a period of several centuries, bows were buried in Mongolia with people. And they were different styles of bows, but when you added up all the distances between the separate parts of the limbs, and that, they always came to roughly the same length, which is, I mean, it's maybe not relevant, but it's interesting. It's an interesting fact. And I mean, the length of the limbs to the tips and everything varied, but the total length was always pretty much the same. So there must have been some kind of system involved. There's an interesting piece in this, which when I read it originally, did not realize how common it was. And we found it in a Persian manual, and I can't remember which one. It's in here, in the Ifādah, and it's also in Mustafa Kani. And here it goes. This is about aiming for distance. If you have a strong bow which weighs 200 rotals, let's say 150 pounds or something like that, and wish to shoot a distance of 300 cubits, which let's just say 170 yards, you should align your little finger with the top of the target on the bow hand. This is your graduated sight. If you wish to shoot a distance of 250 cubits, you should align your ring finger.
This was in the same Persian manuscript as well, the same thing, right?
Yeah, I think this comes from the Abbasid times. If you wish to shoot 200, you should align your middle finger, still with the top of the target. If you wish to shoot a distance of 150, you should align your index finger with the top of the target. If you wish to shoot a distance of 125, you should align the arrowhead with the center of the target. Now, these figures are repeated all across the world. And I think the important point is the 125 cubits, the 77 yards or whatever it was, that's point blank range. That's when you align the arrowhead with the center of the target. And I think this is the important thing. In Saracen archery, the 75 yard mark, which they define in bow lengths, is pretty much the standard target distance. And whereas they list all the shorter distances here, it's pretty clear that was what you practiced at once you were, you know, at a professional archery team. And it goes on to say, if your bow weighs 100 rotals or more, but less than 200 rotals, and you wish to shoot a distance of 300 cubits, you should align your left forearm with the top of the target. So what it's saying is, from the index finger or from the arrowhead up there, all the way down is your sight. And this is one of the real advantages of using a bow compared to a crossbow, in that you can sight all the way down.
Yeah.
The interesting thing is, it's depending on how your arrow is matched to your bow, you can do it on the outside or on the inside. So in theory, English longbowmen with arrows that they were comfortable with could have used the same system. And you know, we fall into the assumption that when you've got these big brawny guys and their super heavy bows, whether they're Arab, English, Turkish, Persian, that they're shooting straight into their enemy and never dropping arrows on them. But that assumes that they only ever fight people who are fully armored up and prepared. Whereas if there's a bunch of guys sitting at 170 meters away, and you know how to shoot at that distance, and they're not expecting you to do it, why not? Shoot a few arrows into them, see what happens. Because after the first dozen arrows landed, people will be putting up their shields and they'll be ready for it. But the first few guys, they might just get, well, one of the English kings got shot in the face when he was, before he was made king, by an arrow during a battle, which involved a fair amount of rather interesting surgery to remove the arrowhead. This people are vulnerable when they think they're out of range. So if your archers know how to shoot at long distance, they might not hit the guy they're aiming at. They might hit the guy two people over to the left or two people over to the right, but they might hit somebody. And it's demoralizing when you think you're out of range and one of your generals gets shot off his horse or whatever. Absolutely. So you don't want to shoot arrows and waste them, because if they don't reach the person you're shooting at, they think you don't know what you're doing. And if they do reach the person you're shooting at and they don't do any damage, they think you've got poor equipment. So it doesn't, you know, you've got to only do these things when you're in control and you know what you're doing. There's a, you know, remember Mubarak Shah and his book in Persian from the 12th century in India. And he refers to, these are anecdotes, an attack on Samarkand. And the first time, this is the Seljuks attacking, the first time they went there, Chagri Beg is sitting on his horse, and the trumpeter is sitting behind him ready to give the thing, and he puts the trumpet up to his mouth and somebody shoots an arrow straight down the trumpet and through the back of his head, and they decide it's probably not safe to attack Samarkand. The archers are too good. A few years later they come back and they're sitting on their horses looking at the city walls, and an arrow comes flying over the wall and lands on the skirt of his armored coat and just sticks there and droops, doesn't penetrate or anything. And he says, "We've only got to fight women and children now, let's attack." I mean, the kind of psychology of shooting is, don't shoot when you're going to be ineffective.
Yes.
But sometimes it's worthwhile taking a risk if you're going to frighten your enemy. Because, you know, we're not talking about people that had psychological trainers and everything to get them all psyched up. We're talking about people who were professional soldiers, but they weren't trained the way modern soldiers are trained.
Of course not.
Yeah, I mean, it's a whole different thing. And you know, they lived in a world where they believed in bad luck and evil spirits and all kinds of things. So, you know, it wouldn't take much to push you over the edge. That's all I'm saying.
Yes, that's right.
There's the next section after that. This chapter is really interesting to read, I might add. It's worthwhile reading. If you can get you can buy copies of Arab Archery reprinted from photocopies online for something like $75 US. It's not hard to get copies of. The photographs are very poor, but that's just a problem that, you know, you face with these things. Chapter 31, on standing and sitting for aiming. The thing that's common in Middle Eastern archery and even Far Eastern archery, which is uncommon in European archery, is that you didn't just have shooting when you're standing up. There are whole systems of shooting when you were kneeling, when you were sitting cross-legged, when you were in what they call the fencer stance with one leg folded down and one leg stretched out. So it wasn't just you stand opposite the target at right angles. And there were so many different stances, standing, sitting, and squatting, I suppose you'd call it, that you might think, well, what are their advantages? Their advantages at the time were, if there was a field fortification or you were hiding behind a bit of broken wall or something, if you could shoot from that position without sticking your whole body up, then that was advantageous.
Absolutely.
In modern times, if you're hunting or even just doing 3D archery, the ability to shoot from weird positions while you still keep your the part of your body that's operating the bow balanced and in the right thing, in the right, you know, alignment, then this is an advantage to know how to do it. So yes, it's a good, and as I say, it's all over the place. There are paintings of people shooting from odd positions. Mahdi Atatusi writes about the Kaluk Turkish tribesmen in Khwarizm,
yeah.
Shooting, kneeling down with their shields completely covering them and knocking an arrow and then suddenly popping up and shooting and then go back down behind their shield. These are valuable things to know how to do. Asaraf talks that the early archery manuals in Arabic were basically for foot archers. And a lot of these things would still be valuable in sieges and things like that. And then in the 8th and 9th centuries, it starts to focus more on horse archery, because that became the major military use of archery with the influx of Turkish slave soldiers and Turkish tribes. I mean, the Guz penetrated Iran, Khorasan first and then Iran proper, particularly dangerously during the reign of the Seljuk Sultan Sanjar. He was captured and held captive for years, I think, by Guz tribesmen. These people were very dangerous warriors, but they were primarily light horse archers. The Persian states, the Arab states, could provide heavily armored cavalry as well as light horse archers, which gave them more flexibility on the battlefield. But just light horse archers could be really dangerous, particularly in areas that were suitable for, you know, rapid movement. So standing and sitting is quite a big chapter, and there's a lot of discussion about whether you should shoot frontally or obliquely. So frontally mean, or squarely, they often use the term, means shooting with your body, like your chest facing the target, and obliquely means shooting with your shoulder facing the target. And there's a various, you can, if you start here, you can, there's various ways that you can shoot all the way up to oblique. For instance, the oblique position of standing for the aim consists of presenting the left shoulder and the left leg towards the mark, with the left fingers and toes in line with it, while the right leg is planted behind the left, firm and straight, and is separated it by about the length of a cubit. Again, from here to here. So your legs are not spread really wide apart like in Japanese archery, but not really close together, like if you were wearing a suit of armor and trying to cover as much of your body with the armor as possible. And, you know, they talk about what it's useful for. It's good for a warrior or for one who is climbing a hill or a mound or an elevation in the earth, since his legs will then correspond to his gait uphill. So one leg forward, one leg back. So there's all kinds of things about the various ways you can stand and kneel and sit to shoot. The chapter 32 is on the variations in length and construction of the Arab bow. And it's quite a detailed discussion. It goes into the pre-Islamic bows. It says the Bedouins of the Hijaz use nothing except bows made of nab, shahwat, or Syrian wood, while those who live near water and nearby groups back their bows with sinew and face them with goat horn, as we've already mentioned, because of the intensity. So there were probably tribal people still using self bows in the Hijaz. Now, you've got to remember, he might be writing about his own time, or he might be quoting an earlier author about something that's, you know, 300 years earlier.
Yeah.